Yes, good morning, and thank you, Jørgen, for inviting me to this meeting to present some of the viewpoints on low back pain and sick leave. I'm going to talk about how is low back pain distributed in populations, in different cohorts that we have investigated in recent years. The next head is low back pain is non-specific, low back pain and sickness absence, the multifactorial nature of low back pain, lifting and low back pain, and at last what I would call a population perspective, results from a follow-up study. Some distributional characteristics of low back pain. In several studies, we have asked this rather simple and straightforward question: how much have you been bothered by pain or discomfort in your low back within the last 12 months? With the stated categories from going from not at all to very much. And I'll show some plain statistics from some of the, it's from a Danish study of computer workers, all computer workers, all 7,000. And you can see the distribution in that question with, and I'll focus on that, around 12% complains of quite a lot of pain or discomfort or more. The same question in another cohort of healthcare workers, the so-called Paris study. here we could see a rather uniform distribution with only one quarter of people who have not experienced low back pain within the last year. And again, the number in from quite a lot of pain or more is 16% in this population. Another cohort, a Danish cohort of service and production workers, and here again the uniform distribution with around a quarter not having experienced pain within the last year, and again around 12 to 13% who have had quite a lot of pain or more. We go on. The recent study, study on sick leave in Denmark in a population sample of nearly 15,000 participants of working age. Again, the uniform distribution. It looks as if it's the same in all the populations around here, nearly 30% not having experienced pain, and in this population around 17% who reports quite a lot of pain or more. In this large study, we could even split it into regions in Denmark, the different counties in Denmark, and just here to see the distribution is very uniformly distributed in the nearly the same way in all the counties in Denmark. But there are some differences if we look at a map of Denmark, and here the percents are for people complaining of the pain at a level of quite a lot or more. And we can see that it looks as if the hard-working people of Jutland do not have so much pain than the more well-off people in the Copenhagen area. And this is from the last study I'll show results from in the so-called Westlife study, where we are studying 15-year-old school children in our part of the country and their parents. Again, among the parents, the same question as earlier, around 13-14% complaining of quite a lot, much or very much pain. And even among the 15-year-olds, there's a rate of 8% complaining of that level of pain. Here, just a simple comparison where we look at the risk for pain among the children in relation to the parents' pain complaints. And it looks as if there's a double risk among the 15-year-old children if their parents have back pain. So, and not to indicate some genetic inheritance here, but maybe some more sociocultural inheritance, maybe a way of communicating distress in the families. I don't really know. So, from some of those numbers, a year without one episode or more of back pain is abnormal. Far most people in all populations of our kinds experience some kind of back pain the recent year. Low back pain is non-specific. Here's from some of the same studies, cohort studies, a correlation between the low back pain and other musculoskeletal pain. There's a high correlation in all those studies with neck shoulder pain. There's a high correlation with hip, knee, foot pain. And there's even a correlation with elbow, arm, and hand pain. And even then, there are also correlations with other symptoms. Headache, we have seen in those two studies, numbness or tingling in the body, correlation of 1.3, somatization scale, we have used here, there's also a correlation, fatigue, there's a high correlation. So we have a large amount of different, what someone calls medically unexplained symptoms, which is highly correlated. And low back pain is, from my viewpoint, one of those medically unexplained symptoms. Low back pain is fluctuating. This busy slide shows again the same question about low back pain at a baseline and then at a 2 years follow-up. And we could see at baseline there was this number with who answered not at all. It decreases to the follow-up, nearly to the half, and there's a lot of moving to other categories in this group. And we know from other research that this what you could call traditional clinical concept is not what is really going on. It's not a big mountain of acute low back pain and a molehill of chronic low back pain. It's actually fluctuating among most people with low back pain, with episodes of more pain, episodes without pain, and it's the real time course of back pain. Is there any relation between low back pain and sickness happens? Jürgen told us earlier that numbers have been said for many years that it's around 50% of long-term. Here I'll show a comparison of, again, the same question about the pain level in the low back, and in this axis, sickness absence in percent from a Danish register of all Danes with sick leaves for more than a certain length. So it's objective registered data on sick leave, and as you can see, there's a nice exposure response relation with actually looks as if when we are coming up in this level 4, which is from my earlier slides, quite a lot of pain or more, there's a sharp increase in the sickness absence. And even if we look at Here's from the same register combined with a questionnaire, weeks on social insurance. And again, there's an increase from around here with up to 6 to 7 weeks for those participants having had experienced the most heavy level of pain. So there is a clear indication of a relationship between the pain level and sickness absence. Low back pain is multifactorial. Someone of you knows this slide from an BMG for some years ago. We know today, and there are some clinical red flags, as we call them, where there are some organic pathology, but it's in the level of 10, 15, 20% of low back pain where we could find some real organic pathology, even with the most modern ways of looking at it. So we also know from the recent 10 to 15 years of research that there's a lot of what here is called clinical yellow flags. There are some iatrogenic factors producing low back pain. There are some beliefs, coping strategies, distress, illness behavior, and a lot of those psychological and behavioral factors have been shown in studies recent years to be of importance in the reports of low back pain. There are some occupational flags, there are some work status, and most studies find a clear socioeconomic gradient in the reports of low back pain. Then there are some black flags in the mostly centered around the working conditions and work characteristics, and also some broader social policy. So it's a very broad picture that we are having today on probable causal factors related to low back pain or to the reports of low back pain. The physical risk factors, there has been a lot of reviews recent years, and if I understand them correctly, heavy manual work have been said for many years to be strongly related to low back pain. I will call, based on studies, there's a moderate association between heavy manual work. Twisting and bending, moderate to strong relation to low back pain. Vibrations, we know that there's a strong relation, but the associations are really small and of no big importance. Standing, walking, and sitting, today there's no evidence of any relation to lifting. If we look a little more in depth with lifting and low back pain, I have listed here some of the most cited studies, epidemiological studies, and here I only talk about the epidemiological evidence. There's a lot of other research which I don't have the overview over, but in the epidemiological studies, there are some studies often cited, they have used, it's mostly cohort studies, they have used different observational techniques to measure the exposure, and all of them are mainly based on self-reports on low back pain. None of the studies could demonstrate any exposure-response relationship between lifting different kind of burdens and low back pain. There could be a lot of reasons and good reasons for that they could not demonstrate an exposure-response relationship. But it's, to my point of view, of interest if one think of low back pain as some outcome who is preceded by many years cumulative exposure, which has been one of the hypotheses in many years. The associations in the studies are also at a level where one would say there's no association in this study. There was an association between twisting and bending in this very nicely recently published study. But in the other studies, the associations is on a level of 1.4, 1.62, and if one asks epidemiologists, professional epidemiologists, how big should an odds ratio or relative risk be before you would for yourself take any action, it's certainly not at that level. So I'm not stating that there's no association between lifting and low back pain, but there's the research is very good research on in this area is lacking yet in an epidemiological perspective. Now I'll take my own view, a population perspective on and some of the results I've shown stems from this study, the FAUST study, an early intervention to prevent marginalization of workers with musculoskeletal disorders. And it's an intervention study of around 5,000 workers on 14 plants, and who were randomized some years ago in a block randomization on plants in a control group, in a group who received information mainly as the intervention. Intervention, or information on how to interpret and how to understand and how to cope with musculoskeletal pain. The information was in the form of written material, meetings, and the third arm in the intervention was intervention plus visits on the plant by trained ergonomists to discuss possibilities in the workplaces to adjust certain kind of exposures, especially when people experienced low back pain or other musculoskeletal pain, then there should be a reasonable way to maybe have another job task for a period, or maybe changing the exposure. The information was mainly based on the British, the back book, but more broad, it was not only about the low back pain. We tried to launch the idea that the same kind of thinking should be applied to pain in the neck, shoulders, and arms. Just a few results you could see here. Here's a comparison from the baseline on some questions from the fear avoidance belief questionnaire. Here's the simple question: I cannot do my normal work with my present pain. And here we could see that those who completely agree that I can not do my work with my present pain, there's a much higher level of sick leave in that group. And the sick leave decreases the more disagreement the participants have with that particular question. And one of the ideas, of course, in the intervention was maybe kind of naive thinking about trying to change those beliefs among the participants. Here, another question: I cannot do my normal work until my pain is treated. Again, if you agree on that, you have a much higher level of sick leave the year before. And if you disagree, your sick level is on a much lower level. Here's in the same study, around 4,000 participants, the distribution of all musculoskeletal pain. So it's the low back, the neck, hip, knee, and you could see that it's split into service workers. It's mainly from health and social care and production workers. And it's less than 10% who have not experienced one or another sort of musculoskeletal pain the recent year. And the distribution, it's quite a Gaussian distribution, and the same level among the two main head groups. And a traditional high-risk strategy would be, okay, we'll go to search for those participants, and then we apply a lot of energy in trying to train them, doing a lot of other efforts to try to reduce their pain and or sick leave. A population-based strategy, in my opinion, would be to look at the whole distribution of musculoskeletal pain and trying to change by an intervention on all the participants, all the workers, in this direction, so as to change it in both the groups with a high pain level, but also to change the distributional level in the other groups. It's actually a discussion which started back in the UK in the 50s about the treatment of hypertension. The same, you could see the same distribution of hypertension in populations. And a lot of effort has been to try to change that from a population-based perspective. And then I'll show some the last results from our follow-up, the 2 years follow-up in this study for low back pain incidence. Here, some of the classical psychosocial risk factors, and here some of the more physical risk factors, and all of it based on self-reports. The ergonomic questionnaire was an adapted version of the Manchester group's way to assess the exposure. But for the purpose of this presentation, one could see that there's really no big associations between either the psychosocial risk factors, and there's a small increase in lifting, but not of a big importance, and nothing with pushing and pulling. Other risk factors showed up. Here, first to look at our effect of the intervention, there was a small effect, but not encouraging. There's a lot of discussions in that, which will be reported later. And one could also see that if we look at the fear avoidance questionnaire, and compare those who had the same kind of fear avoidance answers in the both rounds to 1.0, then the participants who improved in their fear avoidance beliefs had a significant decrease in the incidence of low back pain. There are other associations. There's an association within incidence with somatization, and the strongest correlation, which has been seen for certainly in a lot of studies, those participants who had back pain earlier is at higher risk of having back pain after 2 years. Job dissatisfaction, no association. There's an association with people who have a high level of pain amplification or pain catastrophizing, people who believe that they're going to be very sick or ill when they have back pain, it's a strong risk factor. And there's a small increase among women. So from this broad picture, one could say that there's a, it's not the psychosocial or physical risk factors who comes up with the highest level of associations, it's some of the other risk factors. And here I'll point to a position where it's not, I not, do not look at those risk factors as only personal characteristics. I think that they should be seen in a much broader cultural, sociocultural perspective in populations. There have been some randomized controlled trials on return to work interventions the recent years. The earlier Cochrane review some years ago were only based on those two studies. Now there's last year there was a lot of very well-performed studies from the Netherlands, which I think should be included in an updating of the Cochrane. But the important effect seems to be related to interventions at the workplace and involvement of stakeholders. And my conclusions for now is there's limited scope for preventing first-time onset of low back pain. It's so widespread, so common in all populations. There's certain evidence for prevention of consequences of low back pain, and there's certain evidence for success of involvement of all stakeholders at the workplace. And for last statement, more research on sociocultural and societal aspects of low back pain and other musculoskeletal pain in a life course perspective is strongly needed. And I think the conclusions here, I see them at much at line with the European guidelines, which have been Jørgen also talked about. Thank you for your attention.